let's get into a little bit into the information regarding basic crystallography. So we all know that metallic materials, we usually deal with cubic crystals, right, which could be a body centered cubic crystal with 8 atoms at the vertices and one in the at the center of a unit cell. It could be a face centered cubic crystal with atoms at the faces too, and it could be a hexagonal close packed crystal system. So BCC is basically like ferritic steels, iron, FCC like aluminium, copper. These are known as high stacking fault energy materials, FCC materials, and could be brass, which is low stacking fault energy, hexagonal close packed materials like titanium, magnesium, there are other zirconium. Okay. So you see that though I know that most of you understand Miller indices, but for few of you I would like to give a little brief introduction. So you see that if this is an unit cell and if this is X, this is Y and this is Z, then basically we considered that from this origin to this point where the first atom is the position, the lattice parameter A is basically 1, right? So in the X direction, if I say the X direction, we usually call it 100, which is referred like X is equal to 1, whereas Y and Z are zeros, right? And similarly, in the Y, this is 010, right? And this, and in the Z, this is 001, right? Whenever we make a vector S, it is crossing a perpendicular from the X direction and a perpendicular from the Z direction at this position. So basically we can say that this S is 1, in the Y direction it is 0, and then in the Z direction it is again 1. So 101 direction. So there are many 110 directions in an unit cell like this. At the same time, if we are looking at the vector T which is crossing through the body diagonal, then we can say the direction is 1 in the X, 1 in the Y and 1 in the Z. Therefore, this is a 111 direction, right? In a normal cubic crystals, the perpendicular to this direction is the same plane, right? So the perpendicular to the 110 direction is the 100 plane. The 110 direction or the 101 direction is the same plane, and perpendicular to the 111 direction is the 111 plane. In case of FCC material, we can see that there are 4 111 directions. That is 111, 111 bar, 1 bar 11, 1 bar 11 bar 1. And similarly, the opposite directions of this could be 1 bar, 1 bar, 1 bar, and same. So there are 4 in one direction and the 4 in opposite direction, total 8. In case of FCC, this 111 direction is not important, the 111 plane is important, because the 111 is a closest packed plane, right? If we see that in a 111 plane, which will look like this, so the 111 plane will basically look like this, right? Perpendicular to this direction, right, will contain 3 110 directions, So in the FCC, the 1 1 zeros are the closest packed directions, right? So if there are 4 1 1 1 planes having 3 1 1 0 direction, so there could be 12 possibilities of slip systems, same slip system 1 1 1 1 1 0 type for an FCC material deformation. Okay. In terms of planes, and this has been taken from the book of, you know, Reed Hill. So you can go to Reed Hill and get it. So if I am trying to find out what is the Miller indices of this plane, you can see that it has crossed the x direction at the position A, the y direction at 3 times A, and in the z direction 2 times A. So in order to do that, we just need to put the reciprocal of the distance from the origin. So in the x direction it is 1 divided by 1, in the y direction it is 1 divided by 3, in the z direction it is 1 divided by 2. This leads to obtain the Miller indices for this plane as 6, 2 and 3. Now if this plane is 6, 2 and 3 plane, then perpendicular to this plane is 6, 2 and 3 direction, right? So this is what is shown here separately. I usually ask my students to go home and learn the same, the Miller indices of the hexagonal closed packed materials. Yes, it is little complex than this one, stereographic projection. So in order to understand the crystal system, we use stereographic projection, right? What is a stereographic projection? Stereographic projection is the mapping of the crystallographic planes and direction from a three-dimensional sphere onto a two-dimensional plane. So what we basically do, we take the unit cell, we put it in the center of a sphere, and then we point the directions and the plane of this unit cell in the sphere, and then project this three-dimensional sphere into a two-dimension, and the two-dimensional projection is known as stereographic projection. Okay, so here it is, you can see an unit cell here, and you can see that if I point out like this in the x direction, this is, in here it is set 001, okay, and if you point out this in the y direction, it is 010. If we point out in the z direction, here it is 1 bar 00. Similarly, in the opposite to the z direction 100, opposite to the y direction 01 bar 0, and opposite to the x direction 001 bar. So each of these directions in Miller indices, which protrudes out from the circumference of the sphere, could be represented by dotted points on the sphere, also represent the same, right, the directions. At the same time, the plane, for example, this unit cell and this plane, if you see, if you think that the plane, this plane is the 1 bar 00 type plane, right, and this plane is basically at the origin of the sphere. I will show you in a little detail here. So what I am trying to do is that I am trying to draw a nice sphere. It's difficult to draw, but I will try. So I have drawn a sphere. Alright? Try to imagine it like that. It's a sphere, and it's a sphere like this. So when you are looking from that direction, it will look like a circle projected on the board, right? It's a sphere. So imagine it's a sphere. So the unit cell that is put up here will look like this. The other planes cannot be seen because it's right. So we are looking, and so the one that is protruding out, that is the 001, it will protrude out from the circumference of the sphere and it look as if it is here, right? The one that is going up and protruding will be looking as like this. One down will be looking as like this. One in this side. Right? The back side 001 bar could not be seen because it's in the back side, right? So what we are trying to do is just we are putting the unit cell at the origin of the sphere, and then we are trying to see just from here, making it as a projection plane. Now check that if we try to draw this plane, which is the 1 bar 0 0 plane, this plane, are you getting it? The plane containing this, okay? In case you are not getting it, I am making it three dimensional. So this plane, so 1 bar 0 0 plane, and this plane, if I protrude this plane throughout, so it will meet the circumference of this sphere somewhere like this, like the one shown here, and this circumference of the sphere and meeting on the circumference of the sphere is known as the great circle. So the plane forms great circles and the directions form poles, right? Also the plane can be represented by the pole because direction is basically perpendicular to the plane. So if I can represent this plane instead of this great circle by the point 1 bar 0 0, right? So it's the same. The point is, when you have this unit cell which is kept at the origin like this, we can find out different planes and different directions. Then we can make other directions or other planes also visible, right? For example, if we are drawing this direction, you know which one it is? This is 010 and this is 1 bar 0 0. So it is 1 bar 1 0 direction, right? This direction. So if I protrude this direction, then I will get 1 bar 1 0 here pole. And this 1 bar 1 0 pole also represents the 1 bar 1 0 plane, which is perpendicular to this direction. Similarly, I can have other directions. And it is very easy, just by adding these two, you can get those. So you see, this is 1 bar 1 bar 0, this is 1 1 0, and this is 1 1 bar 0. So we have got information about 1 1 0 type directions in terms of pole from a three-dimensional stereogram to a two-dimensional stereographic projection. Okay, so let's go beyond. So that's what I said, that sometimes the planes are also indicated by normal and therefore called poles of the plane. So the planes which are passing through the center are known as great circles, as I said. So there could be many planes which are passing through the center, right? And all will be great circles. Even the 110 planes are passing through the center, but there could be other planes which are not passing through the center, and therefore they are called small circles. Okay, is known as a true angular stereographic projection. If you have read your geography nicely when you were a kid, you know that stereographic projection were true aerial stereographic projection showing map of the world. It has to be true aerial, because if you make it true angular, then sometimes US will become small like India, and then there will be a fight, so they have to keep the area same. So it's not a true angular, true aerial. And I will tell you that true aerial projections are very difficult to understand, at least for me. And true angular projection is very easy, because it uses the definition of rays of light to just project it similar as it is coming. So you see, there is a sphere as it is, as I said, and there is a, instead of a unit cell, I have shown a just a plane. This figure has been taken from the book of Kaliti, Elements of X-ray Diffraction. And you see, there is a projection plane in which this sphere has been projected into a circle. And here is the point of projection. So if in the sphere, if we are drawing, if we are drawing a great circle, this great circle, you understood? Maybe I show you with the hand, this great circle. The great circle basically contains, you see, the north, the south, the east, and the west pointed here. And if we are projecting a torchlight from here to these points, maybe an object keeping there, and here is a plane, maybe a projection surface like the one here, you can see from here that these N, W, E, and S are projected at this point, basically making a great circle. So if a point, if a plane is placed at the origin, then the normal to this plane, say a point P, will be projected somewhere as P dash, right? So by doing this all jugglery, we can get an unit cell, the poles of each planes and direction of the unit cell, from that unit cell into a three-dimensional stereographic projection to a two-dimensional stereographic projection, right? And that's what we will be showing here in the further slides. So in order to make these things more clear, what we are going to do is that, let's see, for example, there are two planes, F1 and F2, and all these planes from the origin are getting projected on P1 and P2 on the circumference of the sphere, right? Now if I am taking this point directly opposite to it as a point of projection, this point, and then we are trying, and we can take the plane of projection at the center even. We don't always need to take the plane of projection at the north pole or the above, and we can take it instead of taking it here, we can take it at the point C. Instead of taking it at A, we can take it at up to point C at the center also. Only thing is that the size of the circle will reduce. So these two points, P1 and P2, projected on the sphere, could be shown as a two-dimensional stereographic projection as P1 dash and P2 dash here, here. So basically this is the fundamental of getting a stereographic projection. Here are a few examples, and the one I am trying to make. You can see, and if this is a unit cell with this as a 100 plane, then if you are projecting this plane on a three-dimensional stereogram, it will start to get projected here, and you can see that basically this 100 plane is the plane which has a great circle, which is this one, right? So the whole thing is the great circle. So if we are trying to project this plane as a pole, this pole, basically this line, this vector 100 will basically show as a dot at the center of the 100 pole figure. The same can be shown for the 110 plane, and this 110 plane will be slightly shifted, right, from the initial 100, right? So you can see that if this is the plane, then such a plane will make a great circle which is like this, and the other side is not visible, right? The front side is visible, the other side is not visible, right? So we have got the perpendicular to this as this point, and which will look like a pole here, and the great circle here in a two-dimensional circle, right? For the 111 plane, it will be like this, and the pole projecting out of the circumference here, and so it will look something like this. Similarly, okay, so when we are trying to understand the stereographic projection, it is very important to understand Wolf net. The Wolf net is basically a scale, like the one we have to measure centimeters and inches, and this is to measure the position of the poles. So the Wolf net is basically made up of longitudinal lines and latitudinal lines. So longitudinal lines, which are vertical, are always great circles, okay? So it is always great circle. All the longitudinal lines are great circles. The latitudinal lines are horizontal lines, and these horizontal lines, except the line at the equator, all the lines are small circles. Only the line at the equator is the great circle. So this particular Wolf net has a 2-degree graduation. Is the same thing of equiangular projection of a three-dimensional sphere into a two-dimension. So we can use this Wolf net to get the positions of various planes or the relative planes with respect to each other. So this is the scale, okay? So we can get many more examples out of it. Now you see, if we are checking into this plane, which is 120, the perpendicular to the plane will protrude like this, showing 120, and you can see, and this is the point 120. So the plane which is being represented by this line, that line is, can be shown here like this, and its pole is shown by a dark circle. So it's a 120 pole. The pole which is present in the opposite direction of the sphere is shown by an open circle, and is shown like 1 bar 2 bar 0 pole, right? Similarly, for the plane, this plane which has been portrayed here as the 101 plane, the perpendicular to this plane is like this, the vector like this. This could be shown by this great circle and the perpendicular by this pole. So this plane contains the 111 directions, two different 111 directions, and these directions could also be portrayed on the great circle, and it will look something like this when we are putting this three-dimensional stereogram to a two-dimensional stereographic projection. So we have this 101 plane as a great circle, the 101 pole which is perpendicular to the 101 plane, and two directions which are present in the plane. These are 1, 1 bar, 1 bar, and 1, 1, 1 bar. will the, therefore the poles of this direction will lie in the great circle of these planes. I hope that it's okay. So there could be different things. For example, in this case, this is an example showing the 111 direction. And in this 111 direction, there could be various 110 planes that are present, right? So in this 111 direction, the 1 1 bar 0 plane is could be present, the 0 1 bar 1 plane is present, 1 0 1 bar plane is present. And depending upon how these planes are arranged in this unit cell, we can get for the 1 bar 1 0 plane, this is the great circle. For the 0 1 bar 1 plane, this is the great circle. For the 1 0 1 bar plane, this is the great circle. So all these planes are meeting at a certain pole, certain point on the circumference of the sphere, and definitely this certain point or the pole is the 111 direction. Perpendicular to each of these great circle are the poles which are representing the poles of the same planes, right? So if we have more planes to show which lies in the 111 direction, then instead of drawing the great circle with respect to each of these planes, and these are like 112 different types of planes and 123 different types of planes, we can do that in, we can draw the direction as a great circle, because the 111 direction will have a 111 plane perpendicular to it, and that 111 plane will have a great circle. So if that's a great circle, all these other planes, that is the perpendicular to all these 110, 112, 123 planes will lie as poles in the great circle. Okay? So this is basically the use of stereographic projection. The understanding of stereographic projection is very important to understand the pole figures. The pole figure is the most easiest way of showing texture in the material. So let's go ahead. So from very long time I am trying to draw this. So I have drawn a little bit of this. From the 3 dimension to the 2 dimension, and keeping a unit cell in between. And therefore you see that I have drawn few things. I have drawn the 100 poles, the 110 poles, right? And then I know that here it is 001, this one which is protruding outside, right? So if I add this, then I get a pole which is 011 again. So there are few 110 poles missing, right? So if I add this, I get 1 1 bar 0. If I add this, 1 bar 0 1 101, right?
So the left one is 0 1 bar 1.
Ah, yes, yes, correct. So and then we can also get other planes. For example, very important plane is 111 plane, right? For FCC material, the deformation slip is occurring in the 111 plane. So if we add this somewhere here, it is 1 bar 1 bar 1. Somewhere here, if you add this to 1 bar 1 1, if you add this 1 1 1, if you add this 1 1 bar 1, right? All the standard important planes are shown here in this stereographic projection. And I will tell, usually in order to show the symmetry, we usually draw a great circle along these poles. Okay. So while we draw this gray circles along this pole, we can see that when the 100 is at the center, which is protruding out, so it's a three-dimensional sphere. Again, I am saying we are looking like we are seeing it like this because we are seeing from that direction into a projection of a two-dimension. And now, if we look, we can say that it has a four-fold symmetry. This stereographic projection has a four-fold symmetry, and I will tell you this is a 100 stereographic projection because the center is 100. And when we are talking about 100 stereographic projection, we should understand that it has a four-fold symmetry, and always this 100 poles are therefore represented by square to represent four-fold symmetry. You understood? Now, the 111 planes, say, okay, the 110 planes, the 110 planes have a two-fold symmetry. And therefore, I'm not showing why, okay, but you can check by drawing the 110 stereographic projection, and therefore, it is drawn in form of ellipse. If I miss something, please let me know. The 111 planes have a three-fold symmetry. If you check its stereographic projection, you will see that, and therefore it is represented by triangle. So the basic requirement to understand a pole figure is to understand a stereographic projection. So here is the 100 stereographic projection, right? So let's go ahead and see what is there. I have shown the 100 stereographic projection, here with more number of poles showing more number of planes. On the other hand, here is the 111 stereographic projection, and you can see that if we put 111 like this, then the stereographic projection will come with three-fold symmetry. Okay, so always it will be a three-fold symmetry. Now, where we see this, remember that in the few slides before, we saw that if I have a material which is rolled and the rolling direction is this, the normal direction is this, and the transverse direction is this, and I have lots of grain in it, and all these grains are, almost all these grains are arranged in such a way that the unit cell is such that the RD is a 001 and the ND is 100 and the TD is 010, then in such case the stereographic projection will look like this, because you see, then I can say that this is RD and this is TD and this is ND. Please consider a little change in signs, okay? So RD is 1 bar 0 0, RD is 001. Okay. So I will make this change, okay, 001, and RD I am keeping 1 bar 0 0, and this is 010 is okay. Now, while a deformation like this takes place, leading to a formation of a texture like this mainly, and this is known as the cube texture, right? Then if somebody shows this in terms of a pole figure and they say that we are showing it in terms of a 111 pole figure, the 111 pole figure will look like this. The what is the difference between the stereographic projection and the pole figure? The stereographic projection, for example, when I say draw a standard 100 stereographic projection or a 110 stereographic projection or a 111 stereographic projection, that means that I want to mean that the reference system for that stereographic projection is 100 or 110 or 111 respectively. That means the center is 100. For example, this is the 100 stereographic projection. If it would have been a 111 stereographic projection, then it would have been the 111 which would have been the center of it. But in the stereographic projection, we show all the possible poles, many more if possible. However, in case of a pole figure, if we are saying that it's a 100 pole figure or a 111 pole figure or a 110 pole figure, that means that we are showing only those poles in that stereographic projection. But we are not knowing that what stereographic projection it is. So, say for example, if we have a material which has been rolled and annealed to form a texture like this, which is known as the cube texture or 001, 1 bar 00 kind of texture in terms of Miller indices, then it can be shown like this using a 111 pole figure. And this means that these points are 111 points, 111 poles. Now, how could you understand that what kind of texture is this? We just need to superimpose this stereographic projection over it. If we superimpose this stereographic projection over it, we will realize that only if you see these four points, it has a four-fold symmetry. So, if it is having a four-fold symmetry, that means it should be like 100 something at the center. So, it's an easy thing initially for you. It will become complex when you do it in the real life. Okay. So, you put the stereographic projection over it and then we will see that these 111 poles or these 111 poles will come and superimpose over the real pole figure. And therefore, we'll from comparison of this, we'll understand that okay, that it has the rolling plane 001 and the rolling direction 1 bar 00 and the transverse direction 010. Okay. So, let's go to the next this thing slide, pole figures. So, I am coming directly from the stereographic projection, I am coming into texture, I am coming into pole figure. I have shown you that the first way of measuring texture is by using Miller indices. For any kind of plane strain compression or deformation or rolling, we have a rolling plane and a rolling direction, and all these can be defined in terms of Miller indices. So, if for example an FCC material is deformed in 111 plane in the 110 direction and exactly this ideal texture has come, then the texture could be represented as 111 110, right? 111 110 family of planes. Okay. Now, the point is, say for example, this is one condition. This is the same condition that I am talking about. We have rolled the material and you see this is the rolling direction, this is the normal direction and this is the transverse direction. And as I said that many kind of texture or orientations will be developed inside the polycrystalline material, but a certain amount of a certain texture will develop which will have a little higher intensity. That's what is texture. And say for example, I am showing this big unit cell showing that highly intensified texture with its 100, 010 and 00 direction such. Now, this means that this texture is present in many grains which are spatially apart. not specially together, specially apart. Okay. Now, if the texture is like this, then I can put these unit cell at the center. We can take this whole rolling plate at the center of the sphere, and these 100, 010 and 00 direction representing the xyz of this unit cell will protrude out of the sphere at the circumference at these positions, right? Right? And this is another particular example. Okay. So when we have a projection point here and the projection plane here, then if we draw a line, a vector connecting this point and this point and all these three points, then all these three will protrude through this projection plane at this, this and this point. So we have got a two-dimensional stereographic projection from a three-dimensional stereogram, right, for this particular example, where the unit cells are arranged in such a manner. Now we can take this horizontal plate and we can put it here, and when we will be looking at the stereographic projection, it will look something like this. The 100 is here, 010 is here, the 001 is here, right? The point is, this is not a stereographic projection, this is a pole figure. What is the difference is that this is a 100 pole figure with reference system. The reference system is the sample reference system RD, TD and ND. So we are showing these poles with respect to the RD, TD and ND of the sample reference system. So you see that how we are doing this, when we are putting this whole sheet at the center of the three-dimensional stereogram, we are maintaining that RD, ND and TD of the rolled sheet. So we have obtained the 100 poles with respect to RD, ND and TD. And as I said, that in a polycrystalline material, when we give a deformation, the deformation tensor that is reaching each grain contains the information of the applied load plus the grain boundary continuity. And therefore, in each grain and even within each grain, there is a difference in the stress tensor present in different positions. And that's why the GNBs and all form. And therefore, we'll have a scatter in the formation of deformation texture. This scatter in the deformation of the deformation texture could be used, means some kind of harmonic functions could be used in order to find out how the intensity of these points are, and can be related in terms of a maximum of random distribution. For example, we need to calculate that if all the grains contains unit cells arranged in all possible directions, and we say that if such a condition exists, then the intensity is 1, then if a certain amount of orientation is present in more amount, then how much? So the fraction, say it is present 4 times, 5 times or 10 times, then there is a texture. That means there is a presence of a texture, certain orientation is present in more amount. So using some kind of harmonic distribution function, we can obtain the intensified peaks, and therefore the texture could be represented like this. Now the point is, there are 3 110 planes which are coming out like this, and it is a threefold, it is showing threefold symmetry, and it's a simple case again. But we know that what, which direction or which plane has a threefold symmetry, it is 111 plane. And therefore, what we will do in this case is that we will superimpose it with the 111 stereographic projection. And then if we superimpose that with the 111 stereographic projection, then you will see that these three points will come and merge with the 100 poles of the 111 stereographic projections. So if this happens, then we can say that okay, then the ND is 111, the RD is 110 because the RD is here, right. So the texture representation in terms of Miller indices of in this case, in this rolling case, we'll get a texture that is 111, 110 type, right? Right? So let's go ahead. So let's come to the previous example again, where we showed the 111 pole figures. Let's come to the previous example again. So the whenever there is a 11 the pole figure of 111 pole figure looks like that, this we said that it represent that in ND it is 001, in RD it is 1 bar 00, and in TD it is 010, right. So if the same deformation behavior is said to be represented not only as 111 pole figures but in terms of 100 and 110 pole figures, then it could be represented very simply by omitting those poles which is not said to be represented. For example, we take the stereographic projection, we know this is ND, this is TD, and this is RD, right? And in such case, if we say that draw a 100 pole figure, then we will draw only those poles which are 100, and those are so the same texture that formed by a deformation and annealing process, that is a cube texture, if it is said to be represented by the 100 pole figure, will look like this in the poles which are shown in red color, and this is the one which is shown here. Okay? If it is said that you have to draw the 110 poles or 110 pole figure, then only these poles will be visible, and this is shown by the first figure here. And we know that how the 111 pole figure will look like, right? Another example to it is whenever, say for example, we deform the material and the unit cells are arranged like this, and you can see that in this case the ND is again 100 poles, right, but the RD is 110, right. Now in this case, if we are said to draw the pole figure with respect to this deformation, then we will get the 100 pole figure like this, the 111 pole figure like this, and the 110 pole figure like this. And you will think that why it is so. The point is for this kind of texture, so I think that I will just delete this. For this kind of texture where the ND is 100 and the RD is 110. We need to, so this is a stereographic projection, 100 stereographic projection, and in this case ND is 100, RD is 110. The ND is okay because you know this is the ND as we have already taken every time, whereas the RD is this, right? But it is said that the RD is 110. So what I will try to do is that I will try to make this stereographic projection in accordance to my reference system. So what I am going to do here, I will rotate it in such a way that as in a stereographic projection, the RD is on the top, the ND is at the center, and the TD is here. I will try to put 110 at the position of RD, right? And if I do this, what will happen? The pole figure will look like this, right? Now, if I have to draw the 100 pole figure, then I know that with respect to this, where are the positions of 100, right? These are the positions of 100. So my pole figure, the 100 pole figure will look like this, right? If I am asked to draw the 110 poles, then I have to draw these poles separately. I am showing it here itself, but you have to draw it separately. This, 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 and I think, right? You check? These poles. And if the 111 pole figures are said to be drawn, then it will come, you check, these are the 111 poles, this, 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 and this. So it will come somewhere, not this close. This. So I have to draw it separately, but I have drawn in three different colors. So you will get three different poles, pole figure. And so, and you can check that whether it is matching with this or not. So, you can match the 100 pole figures which are drawn in blue color, the 111 pole figure which are drawn in green color, and the 110 pole figure which are drawn in red color, right? So this is how a pole figure is used in order to show the texture which is developed in a material after a processing. So as I said, that there are different kinds of texture that form during deformation, and if this is the RD, this is the ND, and this is the TD, one can show that this is a cube texture. Cube texture is a texture which have 100s along ND and RD both. The rotated cube texture, R cube, it is said when the cube is rotated by 45 degrees along the ND, so the ND remains 100, whereas the RD become 110. So it is 100, 110 kind of texture. And then the Gauss texture, which is one of the most important texture in case of FCC materials, and it forms when we rotate the unit cell by 45 degrees along RD, and then the RD remains the same, that is 100, whereas the ND becomes 110. So the texture in terms of Miller indices is known as 110001 kind of texture and is known as the Gauss texture. There are other kinds of texture too. All these simpler textures could be represented or can be calculated with the help of 100, 011 and 111 standard stereographic projections and can be shown in a representative manner. So here, this is what I was saying, these are the components, okay. The few components, more complex components like brass component form, when deformation or rolling occurs in case of low stacking fault energy face centered cubic material, right. A copper type texture usually form when rolling takes place in a high stacking fault energy material. Okay, in case of annealing cube texture form, Gauss texture simultaneously develops during deformation and dynamic recrystallization of rolling of various FCC material. So that's what I am saying, that Gauss texture, as I said, that in silicon iron, this for having a good magnetic permeability, it is important. So when we are looking at the 100 pole figures, it will look something like this. So see, things if get little complex, right? Gauss texture means along ND it is 110, along RD it is 100, right? So a Gauss texture could be solved if we are familiar with the 110 standard stereographic projection, and if it is said to draw the 100 pole figure, the pole figure in real case will look like this. So we will have these intensity points, and in ideal case can be said like this. Now you can see that from this figure, you can see that 110 plane has a two-fold symmetry, right? 110 plane has a two-fold symmetry, and if 110 pole figure and 111 pole figures are said to drawn, those pole figures will look like this. So as I showed few examples by taking pole figure, trying to superimpose the stereographic projection on the pole figure, you can take this as an homework and do that in your room, sitting, putting the stereographic projection and seeing that whether such thing will show the similar Gauss type texture in terms of Miller indices or not. Okay? So I will go ahead. So you see, we have got Miller indices, we have seen pole figure, and there is another thing which is known as inverse pole figure, which is used to represent the texture. In the pole figure, the reference system is the sample reference directions, which are RD, ND and TD, and with respect to that, the crystallographic reference directions are plotted. In case of inverse pole figure, it is just the opposite. Mostly inverse pole figures are plotted in case of axial deformation, like an extrusion, and I wanted to show the extrusion direction. So how we can show? Here is a stereographic projection, the 100 stereographic projection, standard one, and there we can see that these stereographic projections are basically divided into 24 triangles. You see the triangles having vertices 100, 110 and 111, and there are 24. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 fours are 24. So 24 in the front side, 24 in the back side, right? Total 48 triangles made up of 100, 110 and 111 vertices. So if there is an axial deformation and then there is an extrusion direction, and this extrusion direction is some HKL plane, and then this direction, if I want to show it in this stereographic projection, will come in between every triangle, right? This HKL direction, HKL pole, will come in between every triangle, and this is because of the symmetry of the cubic cell. So what is there? Why to show all these 48 triangles? We can choose one, right? We can choose one which has 001, 100 and 110 and 111 as vertices, and then represent the position of that HKL plane, which is an important sample direction, say the extrusion direction, and that's what the texture, right? So why it is inverse pole figure? in the pole figure, we have references, a reference direction, which is the sample reference direction, that is RD, ND and TD. And we represent the crystallographic direction or the position with respect to that. In the inverse pole figure, we take the triangle, one triangle from the stereographic projection, which has three reference direction, 100, 110 and 111, which are crystal reference direction. And then in that, we point out an important sample direction. And it is easier to show this in case of simple extrusion or simple compression process. It is easier to show texture in form of inverse pole figure if it is a simple extrusion, a wire drawing process or a compression process. That means axial kind of deformation. Say this is an example that I am trying to show out here, is that whenever we are drawing an wire and the wire drawing axis basically coincides with the 110 axis, and then we can show this in terms of inverse pole figure as the intensified wire drawing axis like this. So from this inverse pole figure we can say the crystals are oriented along 110, that is the wire axis, and the orientation contours of the 110 axis could be shown using this inverse pole figure. Okay. After we understood using Miller indices as a tool to observe texture, pole figure and inverse pole figure as a tool to observe texture, we can also go a little in a little detail to see the three-dimensional analysis of the texture. And usually, a complete description of a orientation in a polycrystalline material can be described, can be obtained by six-dimensional space called orientation location space, right? And what is this orientation location space? Say for example, this is a plate which have few grains, and each grains have an unit cell which is being shown like this. Whenever we are trying to find out the orientation, one can say, one can check, we will see that later, that the rotation of phi 1, phi, phi 2 can take in such a manner that the sample coordinate system could be rotated to the crystal coordinate system. Only three rotations are needed. And then for each of these grain or maybe points in the grain, one should also know the position, right? X, Y and Z position, where this lies. So there are six things that is important. First, the X, Y, Z position and the three angular position which rotates the sample reference system to the crystal reference system, that is phi 1, phi, phi 2. So that is known as six-dimensional orientation rotation, that is location space. Okay. So let's see. Let's go into more informative things like texture. And as I said, that it could be different from one grain to another, right? So one thing is that this orientation location space can give you information of the orientation or texture with for each grain, right? And this is basically known as G, the orientation matrix also, you can say. So an information of the texture for each relative position X, Y and Z could be obtained in terms of phi 1, phi, phi 2, right? And this is known as the orientation or the texture for each pixel or each position or for each grain or for each crystallite, whatever you say. Now, there could be another thing. The relation between one grain and the other grain or one crystallite and the other crystalline is the difference in their orientation phi 1 phi phi 2 could be given by delta g, which is known as misorientation. A misorientation is the same thing that we call geometrically necessary boundaries or low angle boundaries, or it can be high angle boundaries if the misorientation is greater than 15 degrees, right. So, the relative rotations, the transformation between the coordinate system, that is the sample coordinate system and the crystal coordinate system, is basically a rotation matrix, right. And in order to carry out this transformation, we need to have a orthotropic sample coordinate system and an orthotropic crystal coordinate system, right. Sample coordinate systems are basically orthotropic, right, RD, ND, TD, all are 90 degrees to each other. So, if it is S1, S2, S3 for the sample coordinate system, where S1 is the rolling direction, S2 is the transverse direction, S3 is the normal direction. For the crystal coordinate system, in cubic crystals, it is easy, right, C1 is 100, C2 is 010 and C3 is 001. But in case of trigonal symmetric material or hexagonal symmetric material, it become little difficult, right. So, we need to convert the crystal coordinate system, which is in a hexagonal system, to an orthotropic system, right. So, what we do is either we decide that we will keep x1 as 10, 1 bar 0, y1 as 1 bar 2, 1 bar 0 or 11, 2 bar 0 and z 0001, so that x, y and z are 90 degrees to each other. Or in the other case, we can have x2 as 11, 2 bar 0, y2 as 101 bar 0 and z as 0001. So, we can decide upon the coordinate system which we will use for the crystal system, so that it becomes an orthotropic system, right. And then we can get the relationship between the crystal coordinate system and the sample coordinate system, and g is the rotation matrix, which is known as the orientation matrix. And that is the basically another form of representation of a texture. So, G, the orientation matrix, is another form of representation of the texture. There are various ways of converting various, like for example, in the triclinic case where A, B and C are like this, are changed into an orthotropic crystal system by using a relationship, using a matrix relationship, right. So, I am not going into detail. For normal cubic case, it is like this. For hexagonal crystal system, it is like this. And why it is different? If A, B and C are different, in case of cubic, A and B and C are same. Therefore, there is no need to change it at all. But for hexagonal, for triclinic and other cases, it is very important to change. So, now let us coming into what is a G matrix. G matrix is another form of texture representation and is known as orientation matrix. This orientation matrix is the angular relationship between the crystal coordinate system and the sample coordinate system. Say that the sample coordinate system is x, that is the rolling direction, y, that is the transverse direction and z, that is the normal direction. Whereas, a crystal is placed here in such a manner that this is the 100, this is between 100 with x, y and z of the sample, that is cos alpha 1, cos beta 1, cos gamma 1, that is 100 with respect to RD, 100 with respect to TD, 100 respect to ND. So, we have cos alpha 1, cos beta 1, cos gamma 1. At the same time, the relationship between 010 and the RD, TD and ND could be cos alpha 2, cos beta 2, cos gamma 2, and 001 with RD, TD and ND could be cos alpha 3, cos beta 3 and cos gamma 3. This 9 variable matrices gives the orientation rotation relationship between the sample coordinate system to the crystal coordinate system, and therefore, is also a representation of the texture, right. Now, okay, So this kind of representation, so the orientation matrix could be related to the Miller indices, and this Miller indices could be related to the pole figure. This orientation matrix could be related to the Euler angles phi 1 phi 2 that I will describe a little later, and that is the Euler space, that is orientation distribution function. Also this could be used for axis angle pair calculations and the Rodrix vectors, which we will not cover in this course. The as similar to the orientation matrix, the misorientation matrix is also a representation of a texture. Only thing is the difference between one crystallite to the other, that is the misorientation angle, and this is also could be represented by Euler space and is known as misorientation orientation distribution function, also in terms of axis angle pair. So we will not cover much of this, but it's the simpler texture we will cover. So let's see, let's go here and see that how the orientation matrix is related to the Miller indices, and it's very important to understand that. So you see, give me a time, moment. A G matrix is a matrix consisting of a relationship cos alpha 1 cos beta 1 cos gamma 1 of 1 0 0 with respect to RD, TD and ND, right, and 0 1 0 with respect to RD, TD and ND, and 0 0 1 for the same, right, cos alpha 3 cos beta 3 cos gamma 3. The angular relationship cos alpha 1 beta 1 and gamma 1 or 2 3 whatever it is a relation between these two, right, and then what is this? Basically this is nothing but it represents the what is cos alpha 1. Cos alpha 1 is u times root over u square plus v square plus w square, v times u square plus v square plus w square, w times by u square plus v square plus w square, and this is basically cos alpha 1 cos alpha 2 and cos alpha 3. And this, what is this u, v and w? Basically the u, v and w are the Miller indices for the rolling direction. For the transverse direction it is q r s divided by q square plus r square plus s square, root over q square plus r square plus s square. In case of, and this is the Miller indices, q r s are the Miller indices of the transverse direction, right, and the Miller indices of the rolling plane, h, h square plus k square plus l square, okay, same thing. So there is a relation between the orientation matrix and the Miller indices, which will represent the same texture developed during a certain kind of a process or a processing, okay. So any of this texture, this one a rotated cube, the cube, the gauss, or an ideal texture component for an FCC could be represented in terms of HKL UVW, and at the same time after knowing this one can represent this texture in terms of simple orientation matrix, right. The pole figure that we formed also shows the same thing as the Miller indices as the orientation matrix in a different form. And mathematically we can show that these are the same thing. Say for example, I have given an example of an hexagonal crystal positioned in this way with respect to RD, ND and TD. This reference direction, say it is RD, this is ND, and say it is coming out protruding TD. And you see that an angle alpha away from ND is known as the azimuth of the pole when alpha is equal to 0, right? And another thing, because of the rotation beta, which is away from the RD, is also represented. So there are two things, alpha and beta. The alpha and beta, there are two angles which shows the rotation or the position of the crystal with respect to the sample reference system RD, ND and TD. So one can say very easily what is the position of the crystal with respect to the sample, and say, I say that this is R, and what could be R? R, say it is S1, S1 means RD, right? So RD is equal to S1 times sine of alpha, that is, you know, this is alpha, so sine of alpha it goes here, and then cos of beta it goes to this reference direction, that is RD. S2, that is along the TD, S2 sine of alpha and sine of beta showing the TD, plus S3 which is cos of alpha. So the relative vector R with respect to the sample coordinate system is S1 sine alpha cos beta, S2 sine alpha sine beta, plus S3 cos alpha. The same thing could be represented in terms of the crystal coordinate system, in which the R could be represented as C1 times X, where X, Y and Z is the coordinate of this pole, right? In this case it is 0, 0, 0, 1. And so C1 times X, C2 times Y, C3 times Z divided by root over X square plus Y square plus Z square, right? The similar way that I have shown it here. So we know that CC is equal to G times CS, right? So one can show that CC, which is X, Y and Z, is equal to G times sine alpha cos beta, sine alpha sine beta and cos of alpha. One by n, where n is root over x square plus y square plus z square. Now point is, here it is shown inverse of G. Okay? So it is shown sample coordinate system, that is CS, is equal to G inverse into CC. Okay? So mathematically one can show that the pole figures are related to the orientation matrix and therefore could be correlated. Similarly, the inverse pole figure could also be related to the orientation matrix in the similar manner. I am not going into detail of this. So here is the relationship, that is CC is equal to G time the sample coordinate system XYZ, that is S1, S2 and S3. Okay? So I am going ahead. We have seen Miller indices, pole figure, inverse pole figure, orientation matrix, four ways of representing texture, and then we are going into Euler angles. So that's what we are calling phi 1 phi 2. So Euler angle is a way in which we can use three variables to specify an orientation. Okay? And in texture, Euler space is, or the Euler angle representation is said to be the most convenient way of representing the texture. Okay? So here what we do, we give three rotations which we have to perform in a correct sequence as being shown by these researchers separately, okay, so that we can go from the sample coordinate system into the crystal coordinate system, right? And there are three ways of doing it. There could be many ways of doing it, but there are three ways of doing it. One shown by Bunge et al. In 1965, separately by Roy et al. In 1965, and by Williams. Nowadays, we only follow the Bunge's rotation. Okay? Everyone follows the Bunge rotation. Why I am saying this? Because if we need to rotate phi 1, phi, phi 2 in a certain sequence, in a certain manner, following certain rules, that it produces texture components or fiber texture positions in the Euler space in a certain position, so that we can correlate. If the rotations are different, the positions of these components will change. So a similar texture that is represented by Bunge will be positioned in a different place in the Euler space as compared to Roy and Williams. Therefore, the texture community has stopped using Roy and Williams notation in representing the texture. Though there are few papers in 1970s and 80s, you can see they have used Roy's notation and Williams notation in denoting the texture. But we usually use Bunge's notation now. And so what is it? We take the same example. So there is a rolling plate, rolled material, with this is the rolling direction, this is the normal direction, this is the transverse direction. And the main texture component which is forming is shown by this unit cell, which has 100 in this direction, 010 in this direction, and 001 in this direction. The point is, we need to rotate the sample coordinate system by phi 1, phi, phi 2 and get into the crystal coordinate system, right? So how the rotations are done? Phi 1 is rotated along ND, phi is the second rotation, phi is done along rolling direction RD, the third rotation is done along ND again. So in order to show this three rotation, I have drawn one big unit cell and a small unit cell. The big unit cell is basically not an unit cell, it is a sample, okay, shown in terms of a cuboid with RD this side, ND this side, and TD this side and ND this side. The small unit cell is the crystallographic unit cell with 100 this, 010